This is the 150th anniversary of the periodic table as formulated by Dmitry Mendeleev. And we at Fermilab have brought together a number of scientists who are going to discuss what the periodic table has meant for them and what it means in their everyday scientific life now, as well as its implications for the history and development of science.
I think the periodic table is a really important part of science.
So I use the periodic table, so back in school, of course, when I was doing my chemistry, and now I use it when I try to understand the behavior of our detectors. For example, when we use silicon detectors as trackers in collider physics.
The periodic table represents an incredible level of insight on the part of human beings towards the inner workings of the universe around us, right? We were able to take these observations, counting, measuring these elemental parts of the universe and draw insight from that in this really unique way and organize that insight in a way that allowed us to predict elements that we weren't even able to observe and then later to observe those and have those observations be correct.
If I try to imagine what it's like without having a periodic table, if we just had a list of all of the elements from 1 to whichever number we're at the time, 116 or 118, there'd be much less order in the elements and they'd make much less sense. For those of us who don't have perfect memories, it helps to see things on a chart, to see the organization, to draw the relationships between the different parts. And so just in being able to know and to use the periodic table, having the chart makes it much more useful.
The periodic table is based on chemical characteristic, but also it's behind so that the nuclei also have the similar structure. And that's the reason why oxygen has the first, the lightest element to have a double magic number. So that's the reason why I like oxygen.
I don't even know that I use periodic table, but in fact, we all use it in one way or another.
My favorite thing about the periodic table is that you get not just a lot of technical information about the elements, you get some actual piece of history about the elements. Because each element has a name, and the people who discover the elements generally get to name them. And most of the elements, the vast majority, were discovered in the last 300 years or so. And so people were doing research, finding the elements, and then giving names to them. The names that they picked had some sort of significance to them, and a lot of the time you can get something about science history from looking at the names. For example, helium. When people were doing studies of the sun, they found some unusual spectral lines, and they deduced that there was a new element up there, and so they named it helium after Helios, the Greek titan of the sun.
I think the periodic table is probably one of the first forms of classification. It really set the playing field for things that we build off of now. So in the past, they thought there was only four elements, you know, the whole earth, wind, fire thing. But now we know that there are elements, and it gives us a really good way of defining things and characterizing things, and we build off of that.
My favorite element is something called niobium. Niobium is hands down the best superconductor of all the elements, and that's why we use it in a lot of different applications here at Fermilab. We use it in particle accelerators to accelerate and bend beams.
I use the periodic table as a visual for showing how science evolves.
We use it in detectors for astronomy.
And the fun thing is to go from the most complex current version of the periodic table to our simple little table, which I call our periodic table, which shows the quarks and the leptons in the order that we finally figured out that there is a symmetry and an order and a hierarchy. And so I make that link into complexity back into simplicity.
We use it in our quantum sensors and in our development for quantum computers. Because this material is such a good superconductor. It is element number 41, if you were curious, and it's named after Niobe, who was daughter of Tantalus in Greek mythology.
The periodic table gave rise to wondering about little quirks in the original version of the periodic table. When Mendeleev made his table, he was not the first, but he was probably the most comprehensive of the earliest workers. I think he had 63 elements at his disposal, and he tried to array those in a way that made sense. The elements that he had were the ones that chemists had discovered, and so those are the ones that have chemistry, that make chemical compounds. So he missed out a whole set of important elements like helium and neon and so on, the noble gases, because chemists had never seen them.
When it really comes to my, you know, consciousness that it's indeed kind of periodic table what I'm talking about, often comes with the stories. So the periodic table is so rich because it has 118 elements. And to me, especially when I talk to students, to school kids, I can talk about each of these elements because behind them there is a rich story of discovery, sometimes you know, mistakes, and so on and so forth.
I think the periodic table is fantastic, but there's so much more beyond the periodic table that it's not everything. There's lots of stuff to find, and that's such a big portion of what we do here.